हेलो फ्रेंड्स, माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर अनुराग तिवारी एंड टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द रिकॉल क्वेश्चंस ऑफ ऑर्थोपेडिक्स ऑफ एग्जाम एम्स प्री पीजी जून 2020. क्वेश्चन नंबर वन, एज यू कैन सी ऑन द स्क्रीन द एक्सरे वॉज गिवन. दिस इज द एक्सरे एंड इट हैज बीन आस्क्ड दैट व्हाट इज द डायग्नोसिस. सो दीज वर द ऑप्शन, वेदर इट इज रूमेटॉइड आर्थराइटिस, ओक्रोनोसिस, एंकाइलोजिंग स्पॉन्डिलाइटिस और सोरियाटिक आर्थराइटिस. So just focus on the x-ray. The x-ray is of a spine, the dorsal lumbar spine, AP view, anteroposterior view, and you can see clearly here there is a calcification in the vertebral. There are multiple syndesmophytes and it is giving like a picture of a bamboo spine. So it is a very frequently been asked question, repeat question, that is the bamboo spine appearance. The bamboo spine appearance in the spine is seen in which disease? So the answer here is ankylosing spondylitis. It is because of the ossification or calcification of the ligaments, because of the enthesitis, there is the bamboo spine, classical appearance of the ankylosing spondylitis. So very easy. Is the ankylosing spondylitis. Now we see there are various other radiological signs which are seen in ankylosing spondylitis. Now this is another x-ray. You can see here that this, the central line or the spinous line, is calcified. It is because of the calcification of, it is the calcification of the interspinous and supraspinous ligaments. So as a result of which it gives like a shape of dagger, and that is why it is known as dagger's sign. Another important x-ray, in this case you can see the three lines, the number one along the paravertebral region, another is the spinal, and another one the paravertebral line. So these three lines, these parallel, this calcification give rise to, we call it as trolley track sign. So that is again seen in ankylosing spondylitis, that is the trolley track sign, very important radiological sign. Another important sign is seen in MRI. You can see here that this corner is shiny white, it is known as shiny corner, or the another name is Romanus sign. The antero inferior or antero superior aspect of the vertebral body is sclerotic, is looking white, and it is known as the shiny corner sign or Romanus sign, classical of ankylosing spondylitis. And another important MRI sign is, you can see the discovertebral lesion. There are multiple discovertebral, that is adjacent, the adjacent vertebral body with disc is having inflammation, and it is known as Anderson sign. Just remember this is Anderson sign, or also known as discovertebral lesion or spondylodiscitis of ankylosing spondylitis. It is because of the inflammation in the adjacent area of the disc. The other options were rheumatoid arthritis. The rheumatoid arthritis do not affect the lumbar spine. So please remember, the rheumatoid arthritis affect the spine only, the cervical spine, which is the C1, C2, and sometimes the facet joint, but this much of classical is seen in ankylosing spondylitis. The second is the ochronosis. Ochronosis is also known as alkaptonuria, and in ochronosis there will be disc calcification. You can see the intervertebral disc will be ossified or look like calcified. This is known as disc calcification seen in classical ochronosis. And psoriatic arthritis will not have such bamboo spine appearance. So the answer is ankylosing spondylitis. Now the second question was, prayer sign is seen in, whether it is diabetic neuropathy, retinopathy, chiropathy or nephropathy. So I tell you that what is prayer sign. The prayer sign is when we ask the patient to do prayer like this, to join the hands like this, the patient will not be able to join both the hands. There will be some gap in between the hands. As a result, there will be a space between these two hands. So this sign is prayer sign, and it is seen in whenever there is contracture of the hand joints. So it is because of the thickening of the skin and contracture in the joints of the hand. It is seen in diabetic chiropathy. The term is known as diabetic chiropathy, and the other name for this is diabetic stiff hand syndrome. It is because of the limited mobility of the skin, because of the thickening of the skin, and as a result of which the joint get contracted, and the prayer sign, that is the patient is not able to contact fully both the hand fingers. So that is the diabetic chiropathy. So that is the answer, diabetic chiropathy, prayer sign is positive. Now the third question was, osteomalacia with high urinary phosphate levels is due to or is seen in. So the options are nutritional or the resistant type of vitamin D or the dependent type of vitamin D deficiency. Before understanding this, let us understand that what is osteomalacia or rickets. The rickets or osteomalacia have common, that is vitamin D deficiency. The classical or the most common, the pathophysiology begins with the vitamin D deficiency. Whether there is deficiency or sometimes there is resistance or the end organ insensitivity to vitamin D, as a result of which the disease manifests. So rickets is seen in pediatric age group, whereas osteomalacia is seen in adult age group, whereas both have the common, that is vitamin D deficiency. So when there is, the most common is the nutritional type. The nutritional type, there is deficiency of the vitamin D in the diet, as a result of which the vitamin D is low. Now what is the action of vitamin D? What is the function of vitamin D? The vitamin D causes intestinal absorption of calcium and phosphorus, as a result of which there is reduced calcium and phosphorus in the serum because of the reduced of vitamin D. The serum vitamin D is low, as a result of which the calcium is also low and the phosphate is also low in the serum. So when the calcium is low, it causes increase in the PTH. The hypocalcemia causes increase the feedback mechanism. It goes to the parathyroid gland and it increases the parathyroid hormone, and it will cause increase in alkaline phosphatase enzyme. So now this is the main mechanism of vitamin D metabolism in rickets and osteomalacia. Now we see what is the difference between nutritional and the vitamin D resistant rickets. Now vitamin D resistant rickets is actually, there is a defect in renal tubules. So when there is a defect in renal tubules, the renal tubules are unable to absorb phosphate. So they do not have the capability to absorb the phosphate, as a result of which the phosphate goes into urea, urine, and it is known as phosphaturia. So as a result of which there is decreased phosphate in the serum, whereas the calcium is normal. So the normal calcium and the decreased phosphate, they have a mismatch in the ratio, as a result of which there is defective mineralization in the bone. So that's why it manifests like rickets or osteomalacia. So the major basic defect in the rickets, the resistant variety of the rickets, is the defect in the renal tubule, as a result of which they do not absorb the phosphate from the kidney, and they go much more amount into the urine. So it is phosphaturic rickets or familial hypophosphatemic rickets. So that is, the high urinary phosphate will be seen in resistant variety. So the answer is familial vitamin D resistant deficiency or the rickets. Now the fourth question was, screening test for scoliosis in school going children. So what type of screening test you do for detecting scoliosis? So answer here is the forward bending test, also known as Adams. Adams forward bending test is used. It is used basically to differentiate between structural scoliosis and non-structural, that is postural type of scoliosis. So the postural scoliosis is because of some defect other than the spine, and the spine is compensatory, the spine is having compensatory scoliosis. For example, it can be because of the hip deformity with abduction and adduction deformity of the hip. There will be difference in the label of ASIS, as a result of which to compensate this, the body, the spine will compensate by having a lateral curvature. The scoliosis is the lateral curvature of the spine. So as a result of this compensation, there will be false type of scoliosis, or we tell it as a postural scoliosis. So the Adams forward bending test basically identify the true structural scoliosis with postural scoliosis. So when you ask the patient to forward bend, the postural scoliosis or the normal patient will have the this type of bending, and it is known as normal. Whereas in case of a structural scoliosis, the structural or the true scoliosis, there will be rib hump, that you can see the label of the back will not be at a same level. It is at a different level, and this is known as rib hump. So it is seen, and it will differentiate, it will define, it will detect the structural scoliosis. So that is the question, that the screening test in school going children for scoliosis, you always do the forward bending test, that is the Adams test. On bending forward, the postural scoliosis goes away, whereas the structural will be revealed by presence of rib hump. Now the next question was ring sequestrum, again a repeat question. The ring sequestrum is seen in, it is classical, the pin tract infection of the external fixator. So whenever there is a skeletal traction or external fixator, the skeletal pins inside the bone, if they got infected, there will be presence of sequestrum, which is known as ring type of sequestrum. Because of the shape of the sequestrum, it is known as ring sequestrum. There are various other type of sequestrum. We can see that tubular sequestrum is seen in infants in pyogenic osteomyelitis. The feathery is seen in tuberculosis and the syphilis. The sandy type of is seen in tuberculosis. Rice grain, again tuberculosis. Black colored or the colored type of sequestrum is seen in fungal osteomyelitis. Just remember, the black or the colored sequestrum. Annular sequestrum is seen in amputation stump, and the ring sequestrum is seen in pin tract infection. Because of the presence of a skeletal pin, they got infected in the bone and they form the ring type of sequestrum. Another important question now, the sixth question. 60-year-old female underwent hip replacement. So she underwent hip replacement. After 1 year of surgery, she landed up with loosening and implant has to be removed. So there was loosening in the THR component. The histopathological examination is given below. That this slide is the histopath slide. Now, what is the likely cause? Whether it is metallosis, ucronosis, alkaptonuria, infective arthritis. Ucronosis and alkaptonuria are the same thing. So whether it is metallosis or infective or alkaptonuria. So just focus on this slide. Now, this is histopathological slide. Here you can see multiple, this black to brown colored, this material. Now, these are basically the metallic debris. So these are metallic debris classically seen in THR metal on metal. So metal on metal THR, when it is, we are using the metal femoral head and the metallic acetabulum. So when we use this metal on metal, there will be more and more amount of metallic ions. They go into the bloodstream and it causes metallosis. So that is the main cause of failure here. That's why there was loosening and implant was removed. So that is metal on metal. The answer here is metallosis. Because of the metal ions, because of the metal reaction, there the loosening of the implant taken place. Now the next question, the seventh, is counter force brace is used in. Now first understand that what is counter force brace. The answer here is tennis elbow. It is the lateral epicondylitis. In the tennis elbow, we use counter force brace. Now first understand what is counter force brace. Now whenever there is a tennis elbow, there is inflammation of the lateral epicondyle. So lateral epicondyle is where the extensor group of muscles get originated. So at this point, lateral epicondyle, because of the overexertion, because of the overuse of these muscles, there is inflammation of the lateral epicondyle at the attachment site. So when the extensor muscles are being used, they pull the lateral epicondyle, and as a result of which there is pain and inflammation increases. So the counter force brace is a brace which is where, which is we worn just below the lateral epicondyle, and as a result of which, now when the extensor muscles, they are used, this brace get compression. The brace gives compression to the muscles, and as a result of which, the pull of the extensor muscles do not go up to the lateral epicondyle. As a result of which, there is decrease in the pain, there is decrease in the inflammation, and this way this heals the tennis elbow inflammation. Now the other thing for tennis elbow you should know is the clinical sign is Cozen test. Now what is Cozen test? You ask the patient to extend the elbow and to extend the wrist against resistance. When we ask the patient to extend the wrist, there will be pain at the lateral epicondyle. So that is the Cozen test. And the treatment for tennis elbow is you start with the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. If there is no relief, then you give injection at the lateral epicondyle of steroid or sometimes PRP. So that will relieve the patient. So here the answer is the counter force brace is basically it is countering the force which was generated by the extensor muscles. So that is the answer is tennis elbow. The other, the foot drop, we use the ankle foot orthosis or the foot drop splint. And in the claw hand, we use the knuckle bender type of splint. So these are the other options. The foot drop, we have the AFO brace. That is the foot drop splint. And this is the claw hand. For claw hand, we use the knuckle bender. The knuckle bender splint. Because in the claw hand, there is clawing. As a result of which, we need to counter the clawing. We need to do this mechanism. So we want the knuckles to get bent. So that's why the name is knuckle bender splint. So now we move ahead. Now this is the eighth question. The 24-year-old male comes to emergency room 6 hours after the trauma. after road traffic accident with a BP of 90 by 60 and a pulse rate of 110 per minute. He was given blood transfusion. He developed tachypnea, febrile, oliguric, and a history of long bone fracture. There is bleeding into the nasogastric tube and IV cannula sites. Now, what is the likely cause? What is the diagnosis? So, from just this question, we have many keywords here on the basis of which we can easily rule out two, and there is a confusion between the fat embolism and transfusion reaction. Now, why fat embolism and why transfusion reaction? Because there was a history of long bone fracture. Trauma with long bone fracture, we always think, and there is hypotension and tachycardia, we always think about fat embolism syndrome. And the second is there was a history of blood transfusion followed by there is tachypnea, tachycardia, hypotension, and there is bleeding into the cannula site and the NG tube. So that's why there is a transfusion reaction. Now, the answer here is in between the two, the answer is transfusion reaction. Now, I will tell you why this is not a case of fat embolism, because the fat embolism usually takes place after 48 hours to 72 hours of trauma. That is on the second or third day, the 48 hours to 72 hours of trauma. Whereas in this question, the patient came 6 hours after the trauma. It is very unlikely that within 6 hours, the fat embolism, the patient will get fat embolism. The fat embolism is basically when there is a long bone fracture, the fat globules go into the stream and they go into the CNS, respiratory, and the cutaneous circulation. As a result of which, there is a triad, that is the CNS, respiratory, and the rash, the cutaneous manifestation. In CNS, there will be confusion and irritation. So patient will be confused, irritable, drowsy, and in the respiratory, there will be tachypnea, dyspnea, and the characteristic in the cutaneous, there will be petechial rash. There can be fever, there will be hypotension, there will be tachycardia. These are signs will be there in the fat embolism. Whereas there will be no bleeding. In case of fat embolism, as the question says that there is bleeding into the nasogastric tube and IV cannula sites, there will be petechial rash. However, there will be no bleeding from the nasogastric tube or the IV cannula sites or anywhere else. So that is going against fat embolism. And the second thing is the 48 hours to 72 hours time, that is against fat embolism. So the transfusion reaction, it all fits, the all keywords fit into the transfusion reaction, that there is a fall of the BP, high pulse rate, there was history of blood transfusion, tachypnea, oliguric, again important point, the first sign or the earliest sign in the transfusion reaction, the renal shutdown, there will be decrease in the urine output. So that is, again, it is because of the transfusion reaction. So the answer here is blood transfusion reaction. The next question is most specific test for carpal tunnel syndrome. The carpal tunnel syndrome is the most common compressive neuropathy of median nerve. The most common compression neuropathy is carpal tunnel syndrome. It is because of the compression of median nerve at the level of raised, that is flexor retinaculum. Just beneath the flexor retinaculum, there is compression of the median nerve. The causes can be multiple. It could be because of the increase in the contents of the flexor retinaculum or the carpal tunnel, or there can be decrease in the size of the space, decrease in the space of the carpal tunnel. So the tests which are given here all are used for the diagnosis of carpal tunnel syndrome, that is the Phelan test, Tinel sign, Tunica test, and the Durkan test. Now the question here is most specific. So they were asking that about the most specific test for carpal tunnel syndrome. One by one we will see. Now the Phelan test is when we ask the patient to palmar flex the wrist, like in this way. We ask the patient to do like this. As a result, when there is an increased palmar flexion for about a minute, we ask the patient to keep this position for a minute. After 1 minute, there will be paresthesia and tingling sensation in the median nerve distribution, that is the thumb, index finger, and the middle finger. So that is the Phelan's test is positive. Because of the increased palmar flexion, there is compression of the median nerve. As a result of it, within 1 minute, there will be symptoms of the median nerve compression. So that is Phelan's test. The Tinel sign. Now what is Tinel sign? Tinel sign is actually the sign of nerve regeneration. Now when we percuss the nerve from distal to proximal, so along the distribution of the nerve, along the course of the nerve, we percuss the nerve from distal to proximal. At a one particular point when we tap, there will be paresthesia and tingling along the distribution of the nerve. So that is the positive Tinel sign. It is because of the nerve regeneration. The Tinel sign is giving us a hint that there is some fibers of the nerve which are getting regenerated. So it is a sign of nerve regeneration. The third is the tourniquet test. The tourniquet test, we apply the tourniquet at the arm and we inflate it above the systolic blood pressure. After a few minutes, there will be symptoms of median nerve compression. There will be paresthesia, tingling, and hyperesthesia in the median nerve distribution. So that is again a positive sign for carpal tunnel syndrome. And the last one is the Durkan test. The Durkan compression test is we compress the median nerve at the flexor retinaculum for 30 seconds or more. After 30 seconds, there will be tingling and paresthesia in the median nerve distribution, which is again a sign of carpal tunnel syndrome. So here the answer is Durkan compression test. It is the most sensitive and most specific. So once again, it is very important. The most sensitive and most specific test is Durkan's test. Well, the other tests are non-specific or non-sensitive, less sensitive or less specific. The highest sensitivity and specificity is of Durkan compression test. So we move ahead. Now the 10th question was actually a clinical picture based. The 60-year-old female fell down in bathroom. The clinical image was given. She was managed conservatively and what is the diagnosis? So in the picture it can be shown, it is clear that this is a case of dinner fork deformity. You can see here that there is a deformity which is at this level. Now this is at the level of the distal radius, just proximal to the joint, as a result of which there is displacement and the deformity is like a dinner fork deformity. So we all know that the dinner fork deformity is seen in Colles fracture, and the Colles fracture is the extra articular fracture with dorsal displacement. The other displacement seen in Colles is, the mnemonic is LIDS, that is the lateral shift and lateral displacement, I for impaction, D for dorsal tilt and dorsal displacement, and S for supination. So these are the characteristic displacement seen in Colles fracture. Colles fracture is at a cortico-cancellous junction of the distal radius. The fracture, the classical will be lateral shift and displacement and dorsal tilt and displacement. It usually occurs when the patient fall on outstretched hand. And the treatment here is you do close reduction and you apply Colles cast. So that is the given. The question here is she was managed conservatively and she fell down in bathroom. Old lady, that is osteoporotic. So there the answer is extra articular with dorsal displacement, that is the Colles. Now the second option was extra articular fracture with volar displacement. It is known as Smith's fracture. That is the opposite of the Colles. That is here the deformity will be the volar displacement, that is the Smith fracture. And the intra-articular fracture is usually the Barton fracture. The Barton fracture is the fracture in the coronal plane like this. So it will be like this. There is a chip which was the volar or the bar or the dorsal. The chip can be fractured. So that is the Barton's fracture. Now we move ahead. Now the 11th question is 30-year-old male sustained road traffic accident, landed up in emergency with hip pain, abduction and external rotation. Now what can be the likely diagnosis? So here the clue is abduction and external rotation. It is the clear cut case of anterior dislocation of hip. Now just focus here. Now if we assume that this is the femur and this is the acetabulum socket, so just see, if we do abduction and if we do external rotation, now with external rotation the head of the femur is going anterior to acetabulum, whereas if we do adduction and internal rotation, so with adduction and internal rotation it is going posterior. So that is, if it is adduction and internal rotation, it is going posterior, whereas if we are doing abduction and external rotation, it is going anterior. So just remember, in anterior dislocation of hip, the deformity is external rotation and abduction, abduction, whereas in case of posterior dislocation, it will be adduction and internal rotation. Whereas in case of the rest two options, the intertrochanteric femur and neck femur, there will be external rotation with shortening of the limb. So that is the intertrochanteric femur and the neck of femur. So here the answer is anterior dislocation of hip. The next question is fish tail deformity in child is seen after injury too. So whether it is distal humerus, distal radius, distal femur or distal tibia, here the answer is distal humerus. It is classically seen in osteonecrosis of trochlea or capitulum after lateral condyle humerus fracture or supracondylar humerus fracture. Now, what is fish tail deformity? You see, this is the tail of the fish. You can see here, and this X-ray, it is almost resembling like a tail of a fish. So that is the fish tail deformity. It is because of the resorption of the bone from this side. This is the osteonecrosis of trochlea. So osteonecrosis of trochlea can be seen after lateral condyle humerus fracture or supracondylar humerus, rarely supracondylar humerus. So these are the two fractures. The lateral condyle humerus or the supracondylar humerus will have osteonecrosis of the trochlea because of the damage to the vascular supply to the trochlea, as a result of which there will be bone resorption and there will be like the distal humerus will be looking like a fish tail. So that is a fish tail deformity seen after the distal humerus fracture. The 13th question is, the surgery including biopsy in TB spine is required in all except. So again, very important question regarding the TB spine, the tuberculosis of the spine. We always follow in tuberculosis spine, that is the middle path regime. So it is the middle path. So TB spine, what is middle path? There are two treatments, that is, one is non-operative and the another one is operative. So what we do, we do not follow exactly whole or completely non-operative, not completely operative. We follow something middle path in between these two, that is non-operative and operative. What we will do, we will do non-operative for all, whereas operative for non-responders or complications. So we start the patient on non-operative therapy, that is bed rest, ATT, brace, high protein diet, high calorie diet, and we look for 3 to 4 weeks of the response. After 3 to 4 weeks, if there is a good response, then we continue the non-operative therapy. Whereas if there is no response or if there is development of neurological complication, so if there is a neurological development, that is neurological deficit, on non-operative therapy, or if there is worsening of symptoms, worsening of deficit, that is a neurological deficit, the weakness has increased, on non-operative therapy, or if there is bladder bowel involved, that is whenever there is bladder bowel involved, it is known as cauda equina, or if there is a diagnosis in doubt. So if the diagnosis is in doubt, we need to do biopsy in order to have a certain idea about that what is exactly the pathology, whether we are dealing with the tuberculosis or this is something else. So whenever we have doubt in our diagnosis, we will do biopsy. Whenever there is a bladder bowel involved, that is cauda equina, whenever there is a neurological deficit, whenever there is worsening of the symptoms on non-operative therapy, we go for the operative therapy. And again, that is, if we start the patient on non-operative ATT, we start the patient on ATT and there is not good response, then we need to know whether this is a case of drug resistant tuberculosis. So in order to detect that drug resistant, we need some tissue diagnosis on which we can do the drug resistance. So that's why the drug resistant TB is again important indication for surgery. So out of these, the best answer is the cold abscess without neurological deficit. So the surgery will be done in doubtful diagnosis, that is the biopsy will be done in doubtful diagnosis. If there is a drug resistant TB, we need to detect the drug resistant, we will do the biopsy or some tissue diagnosis. And cauda equina, again very important indication for surgery. So the answer here is cold abscess without neurological deficit. Now the best results of meniscus repair is seen in. So which zone of meniscus will have the best results after repair, whether it is red zone, white gray zone, or red zone? So the answer here is red zone. So just see here, now this is the transverse section of the meniscus. So if we divide it into three, that is the inner one third to outer two third, inner one third, the middle one third, and the outer one third. So this is the inner one third, middle one third, and the outer one third. So the outer one third is red, that is the red zone, because there is maximum vascularity. So the zones of the meniscus are divided on the basis of the blood supply. So the maximum blood supply is in the periphery. So that is the periphery zone, the outer one third of the zone is maximum vascular. So that is the red zone. The middle one is red-white zone, and the inner one third is white. The white is avascular. So if there is injury to the meniscus, the maximum possibility, the maximum potential of repair will be the tissue where the vascularity is maximum, because we need blood supply in order to get our repair successful. So the maximum potential is with the red zone. So it is the RR zone which is having the maximum blood supply. So that's why the repair when done in the RR zone will be 100% successful. So the two treatment for meniscus injury is meniscus repair, and the other is meniscus removal. So that is known as meniscectomy. So we remove the meniscus in white zone, because there are no chances of repair because the tissue is avascular, and the meniscus repair we do maximum in RR zone, whereas the RW, that is the red white zone, is something known as gray zone, or we can say it as a doubtful. We can do repair or we can do meniscectomy, depend on the surgeon preference. So it is a borderline, that is the RW. So answer here is red zone, because of the maximum vascularity, and that's why it is known as red zone. Thank you.